Welcome back to Varese in Lombardia in northern Italy for this year's Road World Championships. They take their cycling seriously in this part of the world. We've had fantastic crowds all week, especially for the local girl Nicole Cook yesterday, who added the world title to her Olympic gold medal.
These are the three strong players. Here comes the big move by Marianne Vos of the Netherlands. Vos of the Netherlands makes the winning move. Gabe Cook get onto the wheel of Vos. It's going to be a real tight one for the line. Here comes Cook wins the world title. Voss is second and Judith Odd the bronze. And there's history being made here. Nicole Cook is the first woman ever to win the Olympic gold medal and the world road title in the same year.
Well, if you think the crowd were pleased to see Nicole Cook cross the line, wait until Paolo Bertini steps onto his bike. The Italian is gunning for his third world title in a row here in Varese. But there's also a strong British lineup. Six riders start today: Steve Cummings, Ian Stannard, Chris Froome, Russell Downing, Geraint Thomas and David Miller.
Well, Geraint, another Olympic champion here in action in Varese. How difficult has it been to switch back to the roads from the track?
Yeah, it definitely took a while. Like the first 2 weeks after the Olympics didn't really do a lot, to be honest. But I went to the Tour of Britain and that really brought me on. That brought my legs back slowly. And last 2 weeks I've just really started to come round a bit and just really looking forward to racing now.
And how are you enjoying being an Olympic champion?
Yeah, it's all right, isn't it? I think it is a bit weird though. You know, like the 2 weeks afterwards I celebrated a bit, but you're on to the next thing all the time. You're constantly thinking of the next goals and things like that. So when I finish racing now on 16th of October, I'll really get time to just sit back and just reflect on it all really.
Well, of course, the next big thing is the road race. David, it's been a long, hard season, but how do you feel in yourself?
I feel good now. I felt a little bit down in the dumps after time trial, but I kind of, like G said, you have to kind of move on to the next goal. And I'm really looking forward to the road race. It's always a fairly special day. It's always a magic atmosphere. And I think especially here in Italy, it's going to be a pretty incredible day out.
And what do you make of this British team? Do you think there's a real opportunity here?
Yeah, I mean, it's the first time I've ever done it with six guys in the team. So, I mean, we've kind of raised the level a bit. And I think having Steve and G, we've actually got guys here who have done Grand Tours before. So it's a formidable team for us. And I think we can use that to our advantage.
Do you think the credibility of the British team has risen, given what a successful summer they've had?
I think on the British stage, yeah. I mean, I think it was already very well respected within the world of cycling, especially in the track arena. It was kind of already respected as the best team in the world. And I think what they achieved at the Olympics surpassed everybody's expectations. And I think I'd like to think that as time goes, now we're going to be able to move that over onto the road. But I mean, the core program is the track, and I think that's what's going to allow us to now expand further. I mean, all these guys, these young guys coming through, have come from that track program. So I think we have a great future ahead of us.
Well, now it's the men's turn, the climax of these Road World Championships and the elite men's road race.
Here's a chance to look at the course that the competitors face today, 17.3 kilometres a lap, and the focal point, two climbs, the first one that just lips up from the start, it's about a kilometre long, the Montello, and then the big one, and that's the Salita del Ronchi, and that's just over 3Ks long. Not steep, but it's a wearing down process.
I think we can take some indications from yesterday as well, the women's race, how this is going to go. I think we perhaps underestimated those two climbs, which are, I think in the great scheme of things, aren't particularly difficult. But, of course, they go over them so many times. They really took their toll yesterday, and we can perhaps see the same thing, obviously, over 15 laps today instead of 8. But I think we can see a similar kind of pattern emerging where it will be a war of attrition. And the Spanish team have been talking about building their campaign around Oscar Freire rather than some of the other great riders they've got in the team, like Valverde, of course, and Sanchez, the Olympic champion. But we'll have to see how that unfolds. I don't think it's going to turn out to be a sprinter's day.
It might be right there, but we were speculating last night over dinner who we thought the big players might be, but I think it was more or less who are the pretenders to challenge the two big teams. And I think it's going to be a contest between Italy and Spain. Spain have had an incredible year sport-wise, haven't they? Winning Wimbledon, winning the European Cup for football, it just goes on, and of course the great Contador has won the Tour of Italy and the Tour of Spain. So he's a man to look out for in a stage race. Whether he can replicate that ability in a single day will be something to watch. Chris mentioned Samuel Sanchez. He, of course, won the gold medal at Badaling on the outskirts there of Beijing. Then, of course, there's Alessandro Valverde, who one day, I think, he's going to hit the top spot on the podium. He has been in silver and bronze medal positions before in the World Championship. But the fact that it could be a big contest between Italy and Spain could open the door for one or two of the other riders to seize their opportunity. Might be a course of Tom Bonan, actually, Chris.
Well,
it's not too fierce, you know, and I mean, he's got a hell of a sprint on him.
I think really it's going to come down to those climbs. I mean, we saw the damage that was done on the final lap yesterday, and if we see a similar thing happen in the men's road race, it's going to be a little bit difficult for those sprinters to stay with the front, well, to get back to the front group in time to contest the sprint. So I think it's really stacked slightly more in favour of the likes of Bettini, who's perfect for this type of race. He's still hungry after the Olympic Games, not getting the reward that he wanted there. So, and obviously on home soil as well. So I think for me, he's the favourite for the day.
Well, while the race is in a quiet mode, we really have time to talk to the superstar, and we're joined here by Nicole Cook, the world champion. Nicole, did you sleep at all last night?
No. It's true. I went to bed and I couldn't sleep.
Did you sleep in your rainbow jersey?
No, I didn't. But at about 3 o'clock in the morning, one of the Italian TV channels put the whole race on. So I just watched it all the way till the morning, and then I was quite excited about getting up and starting the Sunday. So
talk us through that last lap. I've never seen a last lap in a women's bike race like that. For Chris and I, we both couldn't believe what we were seeing.
Well, I was just running on instinct. It was really everyone was throwing everything in, and the brake went on the first climb of the last lap, which was kind of expected. But the formation, you know, that was all down to who was there and who had the legs. And I think we were just all just on our last legs coming into the finish, because there hadn't been one moment where it let up for the whole of the last lap. It was just attack after attack after attack, with each one of us taking our chance. And I had a go just as we turned left and were just about to catch Warwick, thinking, yeah, Aunt wasn't going to let me go last place, but at least if I was attacking with her on my wheel, and maybe if we did get a gap, then Voss and Johansson would look at each other while Warwick kind of blocked a bit. But that one didn't work out. Then Johansson took off, and then Warwick came back from behind and passed. And
you know every move, don't you?
Well,
what about the fact that you were already the Olympic champion? Did that sort of give you an easy approach to it? The pressure wasn't as much as when you've been in Beijing.
Well, I'd achieved my season aim at the Olympics, and also the dream of my career as well. So I was delighted with that. And yeah, it's been fantastic since.
Well, while we were talking to Nicole Cook, three riders slipped away. Oleg Shuzda from the Ukraine, Richard Ochoa, Venezuela, and Christian Pous of Luxembourg. And they have built up quite a lead over the main field. Pous of Luxembourg is the national time trial champion. The other two, well, pros of mediocrity, really. They've had a couple of wins in the last season, but they're enjoying at the moment their freedom from the main bunch that contain all the big players. Long, long way to go. The race is only 1 hour and 20 minutes old. But the conditions are warming up nicely, and the crowd continues to build. And by the end of this, believe me, there will not be a square inch where you can find a space in Varese. And a crash situation here. Well, these are the kind of things that can happen in a big field. One of the Irish riders going down there. Touch of wheels, lack of concentration, particularly when the pressure's not on, and you're soon down on the deck. The Irishman limping a little bit there. It's Nicholas Roach. Oh, what a shame that is. He's in very good form. The son of Stephen Roach, the Tour de France, Tour of Italy and world champion winner. Well,
that's Gusev as well, who's
another big player
caught in that one. And he was one of the outsiders for today as well. So there were some big names there. A lot of the teams, they tend to, certainly in the main races, number one, finishing with the number one is one of their team leaders. So
Canadian as well, I think, Chris. Yeah, Canadians
quite nasty
there
on that corner there.
Yeah, we had one or two fallers in the women's race. think the, who was the Canadian? I think it was a Canadian that was down as well.
Well, if there are no serious injuries, it's, they won't have too much trouble making contact again. The pace is very controlled at the moment. And anybody who wants to get back into the race will be able to do so.
There's only really three playing at racing, and they, you're looking at, or you were looking at them. So they'll soon get back into the main field. There we are. That confirms the end of lap three. Puss of Luxembourg, Shuda of Ukraine, and Ocha of Venezuela, the clear leaders. 7 minutes and 54 seconds as they cross the line.
Well, that's going to be, need to be probably getting on for 25 minutes, even half an hour, if they were to have any chance at all in this race. But, it will hot up tremendously later on. But I think they know that they are bit players today. This is the longest of long shots, perhaps one in 300 possibility of staying away. But better that than nothing at all, of course. So this is their shot for the day. Sure, I believe that. They've just seen the riders going down the descent. Kevin De Wurt of Belgium has been given a speed of 121 kilometres an hour, so I don't think that one's quite right. He'll be suffering re-entry burns if that's actually the case as he approaches the corner, deploying a parachute.
What's that equate to? It's about 75 miles per hour, isn't it? 121 kilometres an hour? 100 would be 62. 21 is
about 70 miles an hour.
No, I don't think that's right somehow.
The computer's changed its mind now.
And it's rejigged to
Marcus Burkhard with 83.2.
It's more realistic, isn't it? Another glimpse of one of the British riders near the back. That was Stephen Cummings. Actually, it's quite good, this, for the British riders, because they're getting a nice, comfy ride in the wheels. I mean, it might be a chance for one of them to figure in the closing stages.
Well, we've had Ian Stannard up the front and Stephen round the back, and we've got them surrounded again. Stephen's not looking great in this race at the moment. When you look into body language, he's looking fairly subdued, and I don't think he's here for the course, for the full course today. But we shall see. Well, the pace is at last starting to hot up now. They've decided that enough's enough. Nearly 20 minutes lead, 17:43 to be precise. That's enough, and the teams are starting to work now.
Well, if you look at some of the lap times, Chris, 26 minutes and 42 seconds they've been through. Fastest one, 25 minutes and 13. You can work out what the difference is, how far the leading riders are behind the rear of the peloton. But as you say, now the pressure is starting to be applied at the front.
Impromptu board there being held up by one of the commissars.
See, Italy inevitably are at the front here, as we expected. They are now starting to lift the pace, not only of course out of interest to look after their sprinters, but also to make it uncomfortable for the rest of the riders.
You can see the way that the whole peloton strings out. 1 minute everyone's all together, and suddenly this long line, well, you'll find that's over 30 seconds long from front man to back man. So positioning really important on a street course like this.
Now then, let's see just how long it is before this lead tumbles. There we are. Pace being increased on the front. Looks like four Italians to me actually lined out.
Well,
team time trial formation, Chris.
Obviously they've decided the responsibility is theirs, which is always the problem with being the favourites. Some small gaps developed there, but I think they'll be quickly closed.
16 minutes and 35 then. Here they are, the escapees, but how much longer are they going to enjoy their freedom?
Well, that one drive up the climb has closed over a minute off that lead. So you can see, once the peloton decide that they want to go to work,
We've got a retiree from Great Britain. Now then, that's the first retiree. Ian Stannard's pulled out, the man that finished third in the Tour of Britain, the 21-year-old from Milton Keynes. Youngster with a big future, rides on the Lambrou Credit Team in Belgium. Stannard has climbed off. Don't quite know why. I'm sure he hasn't run out of strength with 3 hours and 23 minutes of racing under the wheels, but for some unknown reason, he has now decided to abandon. Well, after that little show of strength by Italy, it's now once again gone back to the same style of race. They're just spreading out all over the road, and nobody wants to play. It's coming up to the line with 121 kilometers under the wheels. Well, Nicholas Roach has had to climb off. That must have been because of that crash, I would have thought. Seen David Miller at all, so he must be having a nice easy ride in the wheels. Now they're one of the Germans in trouble here. Looks like Chiluk to me.
Well, less than 14 minutes now that the gap between the two groups. That's actually looking after Bettini at the moment, just guiding him back up to the front. Never has to push his own wind until it's time to go to work.
It's interesting as well, isn't it, when you think Balan rides on the Lamprey team and Bettini is the rider that rides on the Quickstep team, but of course here those things are forgotten and it's all about pulling to try and win for the country.
Well, we mentioned right at the start of this race there's few countries that can actually make that happen, but Italy seems to consistently get very, very high-class riders, lay down their chances for success in the interest of their country, and they really do manage to pull together a team for this event. And unlike a football match, there's only one person who really gets all the glory. Nobody will remember who it was that helped Bettini get those wins.
Finish fifth and sixth. There probably will be some monetary bonus incentive, so that's what makes it worthwhile.
There's got to be something in it for them, because it's quite a lot to sacrifice, because they're great riders in their own right.
And then just what happens probably in one of the autumn classics or something like that, there is a payback for them, so if there's an opportunity to give them a chance, they do. Here he is, Brusikin, and he's distanced somebody from the back of the field here. Too much for that rider, didn't quite see who it was, but he'll struggle to get back on, particularly when the pressure's being applied at the front, as it is now. The British team are profiting well from this as well, Chris. They're a protected team here, because they're just in the field, aren't they? They're not having to contribute to the pace at all.
I was just saying, it's difficult to truly understand the tactics of the Italians at the moment.
Is this the front group beginning to split? Looks as though the front group, or is it just the descent that's doing that?
I think it's just the descent. Yeah. A little bit of a gap between the wheels and then glide quite easily back into the slipstream.
It's the last thing these three want. I mean, if they once do split, then that'll be the end very quickly.
Well, sooner or later, the words that come to mind, the results will inevitably be the same.
This, it's almost as though they're leading out a rider for the victory.
He's trying to maximise his speed before he gets into the descent. There's a lot of communication going on between them. See Bettini there, just pushing his ear piece in.
Are you in favour of this being wired for sound?
No, not at all.
No, neither am I.
So with today's technology, if a rider is linked to the team car via radio, of course the team car has got satellite television in now, they can literally hear, make an attack, which Lance Armstrong admitted to doing. He said, I would attack on a climb and I don't even have to look around, and I'm getting constant feedback on the damage it's doing behind me. So it made him look devastatingly confident when he attacked and didn't even look around. But of course, he had all the information, better than he could have if he had a rear-view mirror. So I'm not convinced. It also means the riders don't have to do their research with the wind direction and whether there's a turn coming up in the road. Mm-hmm. So it takes a lot of the emphasis on off the rider. And this, well, they're certainly not a robot, but they don't have to be anywhere near as tactically astute as they had to be. They don't have to be as complete. This gap down to five, just over 5.5 minutes now. So I would say just over a lap, and this will all be over.
They certainly haven't given up without a scrap, those three.
No. I don't recall, certainly in living memory, when an early breakaway has ever succeeded.
Well, apart from Ian Stannard, who climbed off lap 8, the rest of the team are still in the race here. Stephen Cummings, Russell Downing, Chris Froome, Geraint Thomas and David Miller.
I'd estimate,
in fact, there's one of the British riders up near the front, and that's Chris Froome, who has now, of course, switched from Kenya and now riding for Great Britain. Froome had a good Tour de France as well, Chris, you'll confirm that. I think he was top 16 in the last time trial.
Yeah, he's a very quiet guy off the bike, very polite and pleasant. He's, he always seems out of place in the rough and tumble of cycling, but perhaps like a boxer out the ring who can be very mild-mannered. He's certainly seems to be up for it today.
This is Bettini beginning to play here. There's a big roar from my right, because they're watching the big screen. Is that Bettini?
Well, I can't see with the sun glare, but I wouldn't have thought
now
so.
No, you can't tell, can you? A lot of sun on our monitor here, very difficult to see.
These motorbikes are really getting in the way of the race. You can see he's chasing the wheel there.
No, it's not Bettini. We did get a shot of Bettini, but he is near the action here, so he doesn't want to be far away. But there is a Great Britain rider right up there, and I think it's Chris Froome. Looks a bit like Chris Froome to me.
Well, I caught a few people napping. There's a fracture in the bunch, but it's not a long climb, this. Very difficult to make a breakaway stick. But not an ideal time to flick to the back of the bunch. So
getting a little agitated, aren't they? Beginning to twitch, the big stars.
So maybe 15 riders there with a 20-metre advantage. Which is not a huge amount to write home about. And actually, one of the Italian riders that did that, I don't think. Very hard to tell with this low sun.
On reflection, it looks like a Czech Republic jersey.
They're back in control now.
So there's Bettini. And from that shot, it looked as though he was actually getting involved with that little attack.
Well, he certainly had got onto the back of it, I think, and he had a little look behind him to see whether it was worth persisting with.
Le Cat was there also, in the French colours.
Yeah, that's Chris Froome in second place there, so
going well.
Certainly had a serious impact on that lead, which is just over 2 minutes now, and the attacking hasn't finished yet.
And it is Bettini. That is Bettini.
Well, he's looking behind, he knows he needs some company. He's not going to do a better part of an hour and three quarters on his own, and he's got some.
He's still up here, Froome as well. With him. Still up there, Froome. Oh, a Great Britain retirement. Oh, so that's two we've lost, and that's David Miller. So David Miller has retired.
Well, we did see him near the back of the group, which is unusual for Dave if he's decided he's going to play. So a long year for him. He's obviously had enough.
Two of the leaders pulled back as well there, Chris. That's Ocha and Poos. There's only one left, and that's Schuster just dangling clear off the front. Racing now for 5 hours and 16 minutes. Well, just coming up to 5 hours and 16 minutes.
It's going to be all over in the next few seconds, I think.
There's the cursory glance. Sorry, just looked over the shoulder, and here they come. So they're about to catch Schuster, who's been away since lap two.
Just shy of 200 metres, 200 kilometres, I should say, up the road. The last of the survivors. There, I think, is Chris Froome actually right at the head of affairs there. It's Balan who's attacking now. He's decided that the pace has dropped too much. Balan is taking them close to the top of the climb, but he's quickly marked. He's managed to get maybe eight riders away with him there, and he's caused a split.
We've had retirees in the Britain team. Ian Stannard's climbed off, David Miller, and news has come through also that Cummings has abandoned. This is the rider from Venezuela who was away all day in that break. And that was Ocha finally climbing off.
Well, Cummings, Geraint Thomas, Miller and Stannard are all now retired for Great Britain, so the men not having a great day. Balan's just trying to keep it rolling along.
Get to the line this time, 17 kilometres remaining. Sweden getting involved in the action as well here now.
So the dynamics of this race might change again, because once we get down to the final climb, all those bit players that are trying to stay at the back will suddenly have a reason to dig that little bit deeper and to close gaps, and you may find that it helps keep it together for the final dash to the line. We just don't know how this one's going to unfold. I still think it's going to be a breakaway. Just needs the right people in that break, and they're waiting to the death. They're waiting to that final climb. They may have as much as 15 seconds.
They could well have. They're coming up to the line now, and it's Matty Breschel that leads over first.
They're all playing brinkmanship at the back. Nobody wants to go through.
Six riders clear. Here come the field, and it's the Dutch that are taking up the chase big time here. And an attack by Belgium off the front as well. It's broken into two distinct groups, the main field. One or two trying to jump clear. Russell Downing is actually in that third group that have gone across the line.
So is Bettini.
Ah, so Bettini then has missed a key move.
About half a minute back on the leaders. So that's not a situation that he'd want to be in. It's a very, very tactical race. So 12 seconds they had when they came through.
12 seconds was the advantage then for this group of six as they crossed the line with just one final lap to go. 17 kilometers remaining, and there is further company arriving here. One of the Dutch riders who just burst out of the front of the main group, he's coming up to make the junction at the back.
Koenigo's coming across. That's Balan as well. But Koenigo, I think he's spent now. He's just way too tired there. Balan still looking strong.
Beckerman is the man on the front then, the national champion of Germany, but that has increased in numbers, the group. Still in there, we've got Balan, there he is, second wheel back. Vegerman is leading. Matti Breschel of Denmark. Van Evermaet of Belgium is there as well. Dutchman that's come across is Robert Gesink, and Gesink wants to get on with it as well. So it's now Gesink, the man that's joined the group, that's turning the power on at the front and gritting his teeth to go with him is Alessandro Balan of Italy. Well, this is the race now. This is what we've been waiting for. Big, big effort here then by the Dutchman, Robert Gesink. And just at the back here, we've got a glimpse of Tosato. Tosato has done a massive amount of work through this race. Far from over. He could still go anyway. Belgium, of course, are still in with a shout. Looking at Van Goolen down there, that's number 45 from Belgium. Gesink, well, he's had some good performances this year. Well, remember his performance in the Paris-Nice earlier this season when he was one of the strong men, just slipping away in the closing stages. So this race still could go absolutely anyway. Looking round to see whether anyone else is going to come up. Balan from Italy. And now there's another attack. It's Denmark turning the screw at the front here. And this is exactly the kind of pattern we expect in the closing stages, the ever-changing pattern as the front of the race takes on a different shape at all times. Fanberger of Austria is now getting himself involved as well, and Fanberger of Austria is a man that's been prominent throughout the whole of the season in the big races. That's Tombak that we just saw, number 174, Yannick Tombak of Estonia. Haven't seen Chris Froome, presence of Chris Froome at all in the front group, but in the third group I can tell you that Russell Downing went through as they crossed the line for Great Britain. Glimpse of the rear of the leading group of riders. Van Emmermaet of Belgium, number 44, just tucked in at the back, but it has swelled significantly in numbers as they take yet another right-hander for the final time. Just at the back, we've got Australian representation with Matthew Lutter. Oh, what's happened there? Overshooting the bend completely. Now then, it looks very much like Gesink is having another go here at the front, and now it's an attack by Denmark. Big attack here then by the rider from Denmark. Hasn't done any damage though. They're all still coming back together. case of trying to work out which way the pendulum is going to swing here. This is just absolutely astonishing. Well, the presence of Tom Bone, and that's gone. That looks like David Rebellin to me that's come through for Italy again. This is where some of the big Italians are, and they've missed the move, and that looks very much to me either like, I think that's Bettini actually that's missed the move. He's down there in group three. Speaking to one of the Germans. But Fabian Wegman, Ballon and Van Evermaet, Rodriguez, Breschel, Lofgist, Giesink, Fanberger of Austria, they're the big players. And it's Fanberger of Austria that's looking back here to see who is trying to go with him. Chris Froome has just gone through the finishing funnel in front of me. So he's just riding on to try and complete the course. Nick Noyens just caught a glimpse of as well there, number 43 for Belgium. Spain also here as well. That looks a little bit like Oscar Freire to me there, who's won this title on three occasions. If he could win a fourth, that would be an outright record. Ballon still here at the front from Italy, looking good, Ballon. That looks like Brusikin on the inside as well, attacked by Belgium. And I can tell you that Froome has now retired from Great Britain, so there's just Russell Downing, the sole survivor of the British team. And he's going to complete the course here, this race of over 160 miles, which would be absolutely fabulous. David Rebellin of Italy has also managed to get up to this leading group. There is the rear shot of Ballon. You just tell you the composition here again is Wegemann of Germany, the national champion, Ballon of Italy, Van Avermaet. He's here also from Belgium, Rodriguez of Spain, Matti Breschel of Denmark, Thomas Lokfist of Sweden, Robert Giesink of the Netherlands, Christian Fanberger of Austria. Rebellin also of Italy is in that front group. Now there's a bit of handshaking going on here. Looks like Bettini has finally surrendered. He said, I'm out of the race. There he is, and he's actually patting on the back and shaking hands very sportingly with Efimkin of Russia. Also being told that Canego's made it up to this group as well. Well, that would mean that there are three Italians. I must admit we're not getting a clear shot here, so we can actually confirm the composition of the leading group that are slipping away. Get a clearer idea when they come to the final ascent of the Ronchi, which is the last climb of the day. Now then, Belgium beginning to take it on at the front here. This is Greg Van Avermaet. Van Avermaet of Belgium, now he's the man that's trying to have a go. National road race champion for Austria here also, remember, that's Fanberger. So it's obviously now becoming very, very tricky here as they are in the closing stages, and the shots we keep getting as they're jumping away all the time from the back group to the front group, you lose track of it a little bit to work out who is in this leading group. But the best I can tell you is Fabian Wegemann, the national champion of Germany, Alessandro Ballan, former winner of the Tour of Flanders, Greg Van Avermaet of Belgium, Joaquin Rodriguez, also there of Spain, Matti Breschel is in there also for Denmark, Lundqvist of Sweden, big attack on the front here again, and this looks like the attack from Ballan of Italy. And Van Avermaet is a stage winner of the Tour of, in his Tour of Spain this year, so he's another man in good form. We've spotted Famberger of Austria and also David Rebellin of Italy. That's the composition of the leading group, the best we can give here with the shots we're getting at the moment. This is the little posse of riders that are forming just off the front. Grifko is in this leading group, so he's made it up there as well. Andrei Grifko. So it's a rich mix here of different countries that are looking for a fruitful finish here of this race that's now been going for 6 hours and 26 minutes. 6 hours and 26 minutes completed of the race, and we're getting really to the sharp end now. Won't be too long before they're on the descent here of the final climb and then swinging left into the finishing funnel. Canego is in the leading group. This is the man that's missed the move, Bettini, twice the world champion, the former Olympic champion. Still gonna have a bit of a crack in the closing stages, as we've got attacks forming once again off the front of the group. That's Ballan just flicking the elbow as much as to say, come on, I want some assistance here, but nobody wants to take it on. Alessandro Ballan of Italy, very, very classy bike rider. Can Ballan win this? Looking at Grifko just at the back of the group there. Also can see in the mix is Robert Giesing from the Netherlands. Right at the back we've got Van Avermaet of Belgium. Not the man you would have expected to be there, but he is there. And we're looking also at number 26, Fabian Wegemann, the national champion of Germany. And now they're beginning to gather themselves here on the main climb, the finishing climb, the last time that they're going to tackle this, the Salita della Ronchi, the 3 kilometer ascent. And these are the riders at the sharp end that are in the shake-up for the medals. Three Italians, Conego, Ballan and Rebellin are the riders that are being shown here in this leading group. Well, if a Rebellin could take this, having got the silver medal in the Olympic Games, that would be one quantum step up the achievement ladder to get the gold medal. Meanwhile, at the front, it's still Matti Breschel of Denmark beginning to pull away from the rest of the field. Robert Giesing of the Netherlands that bridged to this leading group when he jumped off the front of the main or the surviving members of the peloton. Also in there for Belgium, we've got Jürgen van Gulen. Jürgen van Gulen has come across as well to strengthen the hopes of a victory for Belgium. So Bonen, the sprinter, is not there, but I can tell you that Jürgen van Gulen is there, number 45, and also with him is Greg van Avermaet, a man who won a stage in the Tour of Spain that has just finished a week ago. And these are the big, strong men that are going to contest the sprint finish. Ballan as well, and we caught a glimpse of another rider at the back there from Slovenia, has just just come across in the pale green and white. Didn't quite see his number, but it's swelling in numbers all the time as riders jump across. There is David Rebell in the style of one of the coolest single-day operators in the business. Now then, can he go one better here in the World Championships than he did in the Olympic Games? And also coming across is number 43 from Belgium. That's another arrival. That's Nick Noyens. Noyens is another man that's a very good sprinter. Past winner of the Tour of Britain. Well, these are the men that are going to decide the medals. And which way are the medals going to go? Look, there is Rebellin coming through. And there's a big roar from the stand away to my right, because they're watching the action on the big screen. And it's David Rebellin, the 38-year-old Italian, that's now beginning to turn the screw at the front. Rodriguez of Spain is in the wheel of Rebellin. But it's not the winning move. There's reaction that's nullified that. Well, Spain, who looked so confident and powerful before, they're actually missed out here because they've only got one rider amongst this group. That's with Rodriguez. And there he is sitting in the second position at the moment. It's Rebellin at the front. They've got Canego. Here's an attack now from Ballon. Ballon now attacks. And the crowd are loving it. Such a classy bike rider is Alessandro Ballon. Long rangy levers beginning to turn here to try and rid himself of the shadows that are with him. The reaction again coming from Spain. Philippe Gilbert, one of my tips as well, early on in the race from Belgium, has breached to the group. Well, that's going to take a bit of calling, the finish of this one, believe me. There's a lot of riders in the mix as you're looking at the back again of Grifko of Ukraine. Well, it's done a little bit of damage, that. One or two have been distanced from the group as Rebellin is on the left again, and the Italian Tifosi that have gathered here in their thousands are beginning to sense an Italian victory. Well, Perm, any one from two or three, if it comes to that. They've got Ballon, they've got Canego, they've got Rebellin, and the crowd keep raising the tempo of applause as one of the riders in the Azzurro blue colours begins to launch a move. Now, this rider could spoil the party. This looks like Fandor. Burger of Austria that's trying to go away. It's the Austrian Fanberger that's going clear. What a surprise that would be. So Christian Fanberger of Austria has now jumped clear. It is an early commitment. Remember, they've got still quite a long way to go before they take that final turn into the stadium where they're going to sprint it out in front of the massive crowd. Well, the reaction has come immediately, and that move has been eradicated, and it's Rebellin, the man that won the Paris-Nice earlier in the year that brought them across, just at the back from Belgium, trying to come into the action as well. Is Nick Noyens, the man who's won Paris-Brussels and can also sprint a bit when he comes to the finish. There's big Tom Bonen of Belgium sitting in the wheel of Bettini, and Bonen himself a former world champion, and I must admit, two laps ago I was beginning to flag him up as a possible gold medal winner. Now then, they're getting ever nearer to the finish. You see a shot at the back of the field here at the moment, and that is Stefan Orsch, I think I've got a glimpse of. There is Wegemann, the German champion, and over on the far side is Lundqvist of Sweden. Well, is anybody going to chance their arm and try and jump clear here to steal a victory? Fabian Wegemann, the German champion's there. Here goes Rebellin again on the left of the screen. There's an immediate reaction from Spain, and it's Rodriguez that is the man that comes across into the wheel of Rebellin. So Rebellin, the silver medal winner in the Olympic Games, with the backdrop of the Great Wall up there at Badaling. Thumped his bars in disgust as he lost to Samuel Sanchez of Spain. Is he going to get it right this time? And it's Denmark now taking it on. Big attack from the rider from Denmark now trying to go clear. And this is Matti Breschel. Breschel distances himself from the group by, well, a meagre margin of about 15 to 20 metres. And once again, that gap is closed down. Well, the excitement here, we've waited for it all day, like 6 hours and 30 minutes, but now they're into the concluding stages of what has been an enthralling contest, and this is spellbinding action at the end of the World Championship, just the same as it was at the end of the women's contest as well, where Nicole Cook was the rider that tamed the opposition and conquered the course to become the world champion to add to the Olympic gold medal. So three Italians are in the shake-up here, with Fanberger of Austria, Rodriguez of Spain, and Breschel of Denmark. And once again, it's Italy trying to get clear. This is the old tactic, send one down the road, the rest have to react, and then they fire another man off the front. And the three Italians are Canego, Ballon and Rebellin. Canego's on the front looking back. Here comes the next attack, and it's from David Rebellin. and it's Rebellin now trying to go away. But the rest have too much strength and they react immediately. So David Rebellin cannot go away. Grifko is still there from Ukraine. And Breschel of Denmark. Now then, look for the Azzurro Blues. There they are. Who's going to be the next to have a crack? Oh, look at this. The crowd are really roaring now. This could be the move. And it is Alessandro Ballan. Ballan has gone away. It had to happen. When there's two in a break, they keep firing one off down the road. The other gets pulled back. When they've got three, the strength is uncontrollable. And now the crowd are shouting and chanting to my right because they're looking at the big screen and they can see the colour of blue. He's leading and it is Ballan. Ballan of Italy, the man that is leading. Now is this the decisive move? He's been prominent throughout the last two laps. He's got the big gear turning and he's established what can be the winning move. Ballan, who's just won a stage in the Tour of Spain as his preparation. And let's not forget some of his other great, great performances. A past winner in the Benelux Tour and, of course, a past winner of the Tour of Flanders. And now he's got the greatest prize in professional cycling waiting for him. And that is, of course, to win the rainbow stripes and the gold medal. And it looks to me pretty decisive, this. Who's doing the chasing to try and pull him back? It looked like Breschel of Denmark was doing the damage on the front. It is, it's Breschel of Denmark, but the Italians are tucked in his wheel. They say, go on, pal, you try and pull him back. If you do pull him back, I'll react immediately and attack again. But this is Ballan in full flight now with that lovely fluid style of his, pedaling a huge gear after 6 hours and 35 minutes, and he's travelling towards the stadium now at something like 28 miles an hour, and that shot really does foreshorten the distance that he's established himself in the lead. That crowd are going ballistic here, and why not? It wasn't Bettini, because he's won the last 2 years, but now Bettini's in the back group waiting to come to the finish, and his teammate Ballan is going to take over where Bettini has left off. He's got a matter of 1 kilometre to go now, and there's going to be a mighty roar if he can maintain this. Alessandro Ballan, now the 29-year-old Italian, has got about 5 seconds advantage, and they're inside the closing kilometre, and still the chase is on by Breschel of Denmark, who can't find any allies. And also coming through, it's Van Bergen of Austria. He might run out of distance. Is he going to do it? We come in for a climactic finish here. He's into the stadium. Oh, he's got the line within his sights now. Alessandro Ballan of Italy really got the race face on, gritting his teeth. He can see the line. He's going to be the champion of the world. Here he comes, the crowd are going absolutely wild. Alessandro Ballan now coming off the elbow. He can see the gantry and he says arrival, and it means he's going to be the world champion. He's celebrating, he's got it. Here he comes, champion of the world. He's going to be Alessandro Ballan. The professional rides on the Lamprey team. He's starting the celebrations. Here he comes. Ballan is the champion of the world. And who's going to get second? Oh, on the line. Canego gets second. And Breschel of Denmark third. What a race. What a finish. 6 hours and 37 minutes we had to wait for it. But it was worthwhile. And the celebrations are beginning already. The champion of the world is Alessandro Ballan of Italy. The silver medal winner is Damiano Canego of Italy. And the bronze goes to the talented Danish rider, and that is Matti Breschel. And he will appear there for the radio link from the team car that Italy have won. And of course Bettini, who tried so hard, has had to settle for a finishing position in the group behind. But there's the winner, the champion of the world, Alessandro Ballan. The official result of the World Road Race Championships, the gold medal going to Alessandro Ballan of Italy, the silver to Damiano Canego of Italy, and the winner of the bronze, Matti Breschel from Denmark. Just one survivor from Great Britain, and that was Russell Downing, who finished 49th. The gold medal winner and the champion of the world, Alessandro Ballan, representing Italy. Took his moment in the closing stages with a courageous lone attack. And the result
a top prize in cycling, the world champion, Alessandro Ballan of Italy. And the celebrations will go on here in Varese for a long, long time into the night.
Ladies and gentlemen, your attention for the national anthem of Italy.
Well, what a day for Italy and Alessandro Ballan. He may have been wearing number 2 on his jersey today, but he is now most certainly number 1. No medals for Great Britain in the men's race, but this year British cycling has secured 13 world titles. An incredible achievement, and that's without mentioning Beijing and their Olympic and Paralympic success. And we'll see some of the Beijing heroes in action at the end of October in the first World Cup series of the winter. All the action from Manchester from Friday the 31st of October. Access that by pressing the red button. And we'll have all the action on Sunday, November the 2nd on BBC Two from 2 o'clock. But next weekend, we've got the Great North Run.
Join a whole host of stars as they compete in one of the biggest challenges of their lives. All 52,000 of them. The Great North Run, next Sunday at 9:30 on BBC One.
Well, I suspect the party will continue all night here in Varese as they celebrate Alessandro Ballan's magnificent win here on home soil. There's no doubt he'll be all over the newspapers tomorrow morning. But let's just enjoy this morning's headlines, because take a look at that. Nicole Cook, there she is, arms aloft, celebrating winning the world title after, of course, achieving gold in Beijing, crowning a wonderful year for the Welsh cyclist. We'll see you next time.